Our next speaker is to be Gordon Woodcock. Some of you may know Gordon. Gordon has been active in the aerospace industry since Apollo. He is a retired Boeing innovator and engineer. When I was in high school, and I can say that safely because he's not online yet, Gordon was the president at that time of the L5 Society.
Nice job, Mark.
Okay. He has since become very active in the National Space Society and has served in leadership positions for both organizations.
Large space habitat designed for settlements and interstellar migration.
I think we're working.
I apologize for not being able to come, but I just had some personal issues. I didn't really, it wasn't a good time for me to travel. And the first chart after the title chart discusses representative evolution. And like I think almost everyone else believes, it makes sense that space settlement will probably begin on the moon and Mars. With initially small experiments that won't be true settlements, and they'll grow and they'll become settlements. But if you want to have settlements be a real future for humanity, the moon and Mars aren't going to have enough capability to support a population as the Earth does. So. market, set margins. I selected a 70% of Earth's surface pressure, or 70 kilopascals approximately. I observed that carbon fibers and glass fibers, which you probably mean derived in space, are about 4,000 gigapascals strength, which is, you know, it's 60 KSI or something that's on that order. But then I degraded it to 1600 and added a safety factor of 3 because you're building something that you want to last hundreds of years. So it's got to be operated some, and these are just arbitrary numbers. I did not do a fatigue failure analysis that said that you can live with so much stress, but this is very factored down, so I think this could be indefinitely with this drift. So the thickness of the wall comes out to be a quarter of a meter. I assumed it was going to be carbon and glass fiber, and the thing is going to be wound with tapes. You start with this is kind of leading into a later chart, but you start with a huge pressurized bag at very low pressure. The size of this thing, and you start wrapping it with fiber tapes until you build up the structure. When you get done, the mass of this thing is going to be about 100 million tons, or 100 tons per person. About 40 of that is air. The rest of it is structure. And that does not include the internal outfit existing in structure and air. By the way, the mass of the ISS with a crew of 6 is 75 tons per person. Nowadays, the ISS does not support 6 people because we can't get that many back and forth at a reasonable expense. But the original design could have supported 6 people. Another observation is that the shell mass is equivalent to a 360-meter diameter asteroid with a density of 2.5 tons per meter, which is typical for asteroids. So it's a monolithic structure with removable doors at each end for loading the internal outfitting before you pressurize it. The pressurization occurs after the inflatable bag is in place, and you begin with a very low pressure, but you stretch out the bag enough so that you can start winding it. There's some statistics at the bottom of this I'm not going to go through. I believe the next chart, maybe we've already passed over, there was a chart that had a big picture from one of O'Neill's studies. Do you have that one?
Yes,
we do. It's up on the screen.
Yeah, okay. And you know, this picture is about 40 years old. This is not a new idea. O'Neill published his original article in 1974. And if you want to look for it, it was published in a magazine called, or a journal called Physics Today. I suspect you can still find that in the library. And there were lots of paintings like this done to show what these huge things might be. I do not know what the internal diameter of this one was. I suspect it may have been a little more than 3.6 kilometers. Okay, now I want to go to a slide where the title is really kind of in the picture. It's called Overall Arrangement of Rotating Cylindrical Habitat. And the ellipsoidal thing is the rotating habitat. You can see a couple of green stripes that are along the horizontal, along the longitudinal wall, and that's the internal outfitting, some of which would be natural growth and so forth, and some would be buildings and facilities and so forth. Then there's the dome, the main structure. And in order to build the thing, you have to envelop that structure with some kind of a trusswork structure that you can use to rotate the cylinder and wrap it. By the way, on the far left of that slide, and you may not even be able to see it projected, but maybe you can, there's a ring on the end of the dome, which is the drive ring to rotate the ring, rotate the facility relative to inertial space. And then there's a little tiny thing that's pointed to that says size of 100 meter door. And it looks like a little door that's been removed from the cylinder. asteroid belt and in the Oort clouds and all those places, there's a lot of frozen stuff out there if you get far enough from the sun. My suspicions are that could be done. Well, I wanted to also cite this paper, which was in the Journal of Spacecraft and Rockets just a couple of months ago, in which the author estimated the readily accessible asteroid resource being readily acceptable for Earth is 10 to the 11th tons, which could build up habitats for more than a billion people. So there is lots of stuff up there in the asteroid belt. I think there are asteroids with a lot of condensed air in the outer part of the belt. But going to the next chart, which says the title is just air, I just want to cite a couple of things from this. Earth's air mass is about 750,000 tons per person. The habitats as conceived here would be 50 tons per person. A human would process his habitat air allocation in about 10 years, and his Earth's allocation in about 150,000 years. Of course, Earth's atmosphere is regenerated by plant growth and other physical processes. And the idea of these habitats is you do think that agriculture and other plants provide the atmosphere processing. You might need some chemical, electrochemical processing to keep the balances right, keep the air cleaned up, but it would basically be a natural air environment like we have here on Earth. The next chart is called Energy and Environmental Maintenance. It turns out that if you provide illumination for agriculture, what I selected was 5 kilowatt hours per meter squared per day, which is about what you get on Earth of sunlight with farmland. You might be able to tailor the light spectrum and reduce this a bit, but it's a lot of power. We're talking about 20 to 25,000 megawatts for each one of these habitats. If the habitat rotation were normal, and that's light power, so if you're doing that with electrical power, it's more electrical power than that, because that's the actual 25,000 megawatts of light. If the habitat rotation axis is normal to the orbit plane, you could outfit big solar concentrators in the domes and concentrate natural sunlight in high density light bites and distribute that to the agricultural areas. You probably need to do some work on light bite technology to be able to handle these kinds of powers without some difficulty, and I have no idea which is best. So the last bullet says somebody needs to do that trade study to figure out which is the best. Chart on other subsystems, we're getting close to the end here. Attitude control, the rotating cylinder of the geometry that I chose is inertially riveted rigid. It will continue to rotate in the same with the axis orientation that it has. You might need a little bit of thrust occasionally to trim it, but it's a stable rotation. What you want is the axis of rotation perpendicular to the plane of the orbit so that it stays with the same general geometry. Thermal control, you need about 23,000 megawatts electric power just to dissipate all the power you're putting in there with sunlight, with either artificial light or concentrated sunlight in order to maintain the tooth growth. So if you look at propulsion, and you say, I'm going to use electric propulsion for transport to the and to and station keeping in the operating location, which might be an Earth Moon vibration point or something like that. And you apply, and you say, well, I'm not going to grow crops, so I'm moving this thing because that's prior to having it being inhabited. It turns out that if you run electric propulsion with ISPs in the 2,000 to 500 range, which is pretty typical for today's electric propulsion, then the power that you probably would have available would give you around 10 to the minus 6 to 10 to the minus 5 G's acceleration, and that would probably, for any fast gals, which isn't very much pressure, it's 0.0015 PSI, that will inflate it. But this bag is so big that if you make it with the condition that I had in mind, it's a substantial pressure. Winding tip is derived from asteroid materials. It could be any reasonable mixture of glass and carbon fiber, and maybe some metal fiber woven in there to prevent static charging. And as the shell is wound, it would be gradually pressurized so that the winding process is done at a relatively constant stress, and you don't de-stress all the inside windings as you're winding the whole outside ones off. You need to not fit this thing with anything that won't go through an airlock. I had in mind a 10 meters size airlock. But anything you're going to outfit, you know, like buildings and so forth, that's all going to get built before you wind this thing all the way. And each layer of tape would be coated with some thin layer of adhesive, or perhaps maybe an electrostatic adhesive. And you want to constant stress on all layers. Now, the next to last chart says developing the asteroid resource. And the greatest challenge may be production of winding fiber tapes from asteroids. High-strength fibers can be derived from silica and carbon, and you know, almost any crystalline rock material can be made into a fiber. In order to make this winding scheme feasible, you first have to identify plentiful asteroid materials that can be used, and that probably means either bringing in a representative asteroid somewhere near Earth or going to one to visit. You could probably do it with an automated spacecraft rather than people initially. You want to obtain asteroid samples to be able to do the materials resource so that the materials research, so you know how to develop the fiber production processes. And then obtain samples of the most promising materials in enough quantity. Again, all this probably could be robotic spacecraft, to develop prototype fiber production systems. And then build and test autonomous machines capable of producing fiber from asteroids in space. Build and deploy the machines to select the asteroids. And then deliver the fibers to the construction site so that you can build the habitats. Kind of into the conclusions chart.
We got it.
Yeah. Two important uses for a very long duration, indefinite duration space habitat. One is space settlements and a permanent residence habitat vessel. The other one is interstellar migration with propulsion based on known physics. Almost everything you see about interstellar travel nowadays, including the recent movie, relies on things that you may as well call it magic insofar as actually knowing how to do any of it. I believe the gimmick in the movie was a wormhole. I'm highly skeptical that such things exist anywhere in the universe. It was presumed that artificial gravity is required for lifelong health. That's an assumption. We don't know that. It might not need to rotate. The million people was an arbitrary size. Building one of these things is a huge project, and undoubtedly one would build many smaller ones. You can build a road. it wouldn't. It's just, nobody's tried it. It's a big project. The resources can be moved from the asteroid belt to a site near Earth. And somewhere I calculated, if you're going to use all of the available asteroidal material, you can construct habitats for thousands of times the current population of the Earth. The earlier figure that I gave was for ones that are called conveniently accessible from Earth, and most of them are not. And also there's some big ones that you'd have to have big, pretty good technology to even dismantle in the first place. My guess is that the first build of anything like this size is at least 100 years from now, and that is a totally wild guess. I didn't even draw a schedule, but I'm just guessing. It's similar to, it's conceptually similar to 100 years ago, which was the beginning of World War I, and flight technology was a few years old, and the airplanes were pretty simple in most ways, to what we do today and with flying systems. Maybe it's further than that, but it's not the next project. It's probably 100 years from now. And it obviously needs to be preceded by an extensive program of smaller settlements on the Moon and Mars, where the resources are there on the surface for you to use. And you have, it's obviously necessary to prove all these technologies before you build anything as big as this big settlement, to have as many times, if you build enough of them, many times Earth's current population. And that's it.
Very good, Gordon. Thank you. Well, we're hoping. Does anyone have any questions? You know, hands have gone up. We need to get the runners to get the mic over there. Where's the, hold on 1 second. Oh, he's got it. Well, you're doing everything, aren't you?
Yep.
Okay. I can't hear the question.
Hello, you mentioned bioregeneration, and this gives rise to thoughts about how long can a civilization survive without other life, plants, and animals, and are they required and for what purposes? Do you have any thoughts on the biodiversity required, maybe extinction rates, tipping points for human extinction or settlement failure due to the lack thereof?
Did you hear that, Gordon?
Yeah, I heard most of it. Do I have any thoughts about the biodiversity that's needed?
Yes.
Plants, I don't think anybody really knows. We know what works on Earth, more or less. We actually don't know that much about it. If you tried to draw build a flow diagram of how everything is processed on Earth to maintain this habitability, there'd be easy stuff like how plants produce oxygen. There'd be hard stuff that we really don't know much about, like what do microbes do and what good are they and so on. But I am thinking that when you get to higher animals, that probably you can kind of pick what you want. But in terms of the basic biological diversity, I would be inclined to think you ought to start something as close as diverse as you can to what's here on Earth, and you ought to try it out in a small settlement on the Moon or Mars somewhere, where you could evacuate the people if it doesn't work, and get lots of years of experience in that before you actually put one of these things in space and fill it up with whatever you think it needs. So there's research project number one of maybe 100 or 1,000
You're getting lots of nods of affirmation. Okay, I think that's about all we have time for. Thank you for calling in, Gordon. We miss you. Wish you were here. Thank you.